It's funny because we don't play the song like this anymore.
Yeah, I know. I like the way that you play it now, but I wish it had the.
I think you're expecting it, right?
It's still good.
Hey, everybody.
Hey.
We're back.
We are back. The Flat Out Fever F1 podcast
has returned.
Yep. Sorry about the little break that we've had, but we met, as you can see, I have a lot more desk room over here because we have one of us is missing.
Danny.
Danny's missing. He's in Jamaica right now.
He's missing this great weather.
Yeah. I'm sure he has a little better weather down there.
That's me.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, it's good though, cause now we're back.
And
that's what's important. Once he gets back, we have been saying for the past like 4 or 5 podcasts that regular service will resume soon, but it will.
But we have special announcements.
Hey, I'd say that what we haven't like put out in terms of content, we've made up in quality of content.
I agree.
You know what I mean?
Javier, I totally agree.
And today is no exception because...
We have our good friends from the 5Lights podcast.
Yeah, all the way from Norfolk in England and somewhere else in the East in
England. The technology brings
people
together.
Lincoln in England. Yeah, this wouldn't have been possible...
Without technology,
you know, prior to 1991. That's when the internet, as far as I'm concerned,
you're right.
Yeah. Well, it was the internet existed before, but the World Wide Web, like as we know it, is created by Sir Tim Berners-Lee in CERN. Happened in 1991.
This is what it is.
He
did it.
And actually, since then, lots of great racing has happened in Formula One as well because of technological advancements, one of which we're gonna be privileged right now to. So yeah, the guys from the 5Lights podcast. I think they've been doing it for roughly the same amount of time that we have. Good guys. They put out 2 episodes a week, so they're obviously working way harder than we are.
They are crushing us. They're like one if we're lucky.
If we're lucky.
Like, I don't know, I gotta be somewhere.
Yeah, I gotta move. I'm sick. Anyways, but other than that, I mean, what the most recent thing that happened since last? Okay, how good was that Tatiana Calderon interview?
Holy moly! What a cool lady.
If you're joining us just now, and missed last week's the last episode that we have, episode 15. Now this is 16. Episode 16 was by far one of the most enjoyable to do because Tatiana Calderon, and for those of you who don't know, she races European Formula 3. That is the racing series that Max Verstappen came from, and it's the racing series that our boy Lance Stroll is racing in right now. She's the only woman, the only girl in that series, and by far, by many, many, many... opinion of people that are like way more into this than I am, say that she is the most promising female driver right now in the F1 feeder series. And we had the privilege of having her here on our plucky little podcast.
Yeah.
And she was phenomenal.
Yeah, she was so great. If she realized the room that we were in while we were interviewing her, she'd be like, the fuck did I sign up for?
I think she realized quite quickly, but still.
But she seemed to enjoy herself and...
We did too.
Oh, we totally did. And she was so cool. Like, just so down to earth and just no bullshit. You know what I mean?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, she was... Yeah,
to the point.
This is how it is. Great. Yeah, quite very refreshing to hear. Also, since then, we've had the Bahrain Grand Prix. Mm. Bahrain Grand Prix was good. It wasn't as good as last year's Bahrain Grand Prix, but... Last year's Bahrain Grand Prix is going to be hard to beat. It was action packed from the beginning to the end. Well, bear in mind, it was basically like in the same order. So fourth race of the year, but it had a lot of action. Like in and it was most of it, it was inter-team action. So, like, there were the two Ferraris battling each other, two Mercedes, especially the two Mercedes. Like,
was that still with Lewis and Rosberg?
Yeah. That was, like, when things were starting to, like, heat up in between. Before all the bullshit, before all the Rosberg bullshit, this was, like, the first race where, like, they were, like, overtaking each other. Like one lap Lewis was ahead, one lap Rosberg was ahead. It was crazy. It was a great race.
Holy shit.
Great racing. From last year to this year, like, we knew it was going to be hard to beat. That was going to be a Bahrain Grand Prix. It's probably the best Bahrain Grand Prix that we're going to have for a long time. Mm-hmm. So obviously it wasn't that this year, but there was still tons of action.
Yeah.
Lewis.
And it's at nighttime.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
That's new.
The sparks there. Yeah. That was cool. By now, if you are a listener of many podcasts, I'm sure you've heard ad nauseum everything that there is to hear about the Bahrain Grand Prix. So we're probably gonna keep that a bit short and focus on this interview. So, well, would you mind?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Hold up.
While that's happening, I'm just gonna right now talk about the upcoming Grand Prix. And the upcoming Grand Prix is the Spanish Grand Prix. And the Spanish Grand Prix is obviously very important because it gives the team, and this year specifically, is going to give the teams 3 weeks since the last Grand Prix till now to get their shit together. And a lot of teams have been, you know, like the backmarkers in Marussia. From all the way back to Marussia, like through McLaren, all the way to Ferrari and Mercedes, they've been saying that everybody's expecting big updates on their cars. Because, like, remember, like, F1 is not just... there's, of course, the driver's championship, but there's a constructor championship.
Right.
And the teams are constantly working to improve their car.
Right.
And that is one of, like... in my opinion, one of the most exciting aspects of F1 is that one team can come right out of nowhere and in the middle of a year, or especially in the European
races. But I mean,
it
seems like Mercedes is clearly...
Mercedes is going to be hard to beat. All right. Yeah, let's do it. Yeah, bear with us. Okay. So we are connecting right now with the guys from the 5Lights F1 podcast.
Hello. Hi, everyone.
Hey, yes!
We're here. We go. It works!
Yes, so we're here with Ben and Dan from the 5Lights F1 podcast.
We did it.
Yeah. And we're actually showing on the screen. Everybody's on the screen. Hey, everybody say hi. I guess at this time it would be, hey, you're gonna use the audio for this for your own stuff. So do you want to do like an introduction for your, like, okay, come on, do it.
Yeah, let's build this up, Ben. So, I mean, usually let's do like a proper introduction, shall we, Ben? I mean,
yes.
Welcome to the 5Lights podcast. This is a special 5Lights podcast. We are guesting on the Flat Out Fever podcast with our friends across the pond. There's going to be a video on YouTube, so we'll put a link to that, and we'll tell you about the link later on. But first, I need to introduce my compadre, my brother. He's the Adrian Newey to my Nigel Mansell. Ben, how you doing?
I'm good, buddy. How are you?
I'm good. Should we introduce the other two guys who have joined us today as well? Let's get in on this.
Yeah.
So guys from the Flat Out Fever podcast, how you doing?
Pretty good.
Doing well.
Yeah.
Doing well.
Doing really well. Go ahead.
So for our podcast listeners, just introduce yourselves individually so we know who we're talking to.
I am Jay, or Javier, whichever one you prefer. White people like to call me Jay because they find Javier a bit complicated. But I'm joined here by
Mike or Michael Schmidt. Either one,
yeah,
it's fine. No. White people don't have a problem with it.
I know. And we're missing one of our guys. One of our guys is right now actually on vacation, and that is actually why we have we've had a little bit of a gap in our regular of putting out podcasts. He's out in Jamaica, probably smoking some legal weed. But that's Dan. Our Dan, not you, but he would normally be sitting here taking some space from me, but now luckily I got all this room. I can really feel.
You can really move around.
Yeah,
you can do some yoga or cheap whatever.
And there's a new Dan on the scene now anyway. So
there we go.
Yeah, well, so it makes it complicated, doesn't it? Let's face
it. So to all your listeners, I mean, I know that you said across the pond, and many times that means America, but we are actually from Canada.
Toronto, in fact.
We're from Toronto, and we're talking about, we're going to be talking about F1.
Yes. Javier, though. Yeah. It's easy for me. I'm British, see. you don't sound like you've got a Canadian accent, though. That's not a Canadian accent you're rocking right there.
When I moved here about 12 years ago, I came to Canada with some English knowledge. Like I you know, but being from a third world country, I know that you guys don't get it, but they tend to teach you English because English is like, you know, if you want to have any kind of like hope for the future, you got to learn some English to be able to like do some, you know, any international business. You require some English. So
sure.
I had a minimum vocabulary and whatnot when I moved here. And since then, I guess I've kind of honed it, but I don't know. Like,
you still sound foreign to me.
Thank you, Mike.
Hey, it's not an insult.
What would you describe as a Canadian accent, though?
Oh, well, we've obviously got the old stereotypes, haven't we, over here? The aboot is the main one. That's all Canadians ever say is aboot. And they're overly polite. That's all we get over here from watching South Park and Ice Road Truckers.
Well,
you're originally from Colombia, yeah?
Yeah, I'm from Colombia, South America, birthplace of the likes of Juan Pablo Montoya.
a delightful man.
Oh, yeah. No, actually, it, much like you guys, I think he's a brick. Oh, actually, you know what? This is a matter of like almost national shame because he had so much promise, but then he got to F1, and I always say that like he just let his ego get the most of him and tried some stupid moves. He was basically the Maldonado of his.
God.
He had a bit more. He had a bit more talent though, didn't he? He could win races, and he's proved in IndyCar that he's a talented driver. I think he just had a massive chip on his shoulder. That was Juan Pablo Montoya's problem.
Yeah,
but Ben, he was a bit before your time, wasn't he, Ben? Juan Pablo.
Ish. I know of him. I know of someone called Montoya. See, as you said, Jay, Maldonado is my Montoya. So.
Yeah. How old are you guys till now?
To be fair, though, Montoya. Like I guess if you compare stats, Montoya was a better driver. Maybe like he still holds the lap record for Monza. So
I did not know that.
Yeah, that's gonna count for something.
BMW,
yeah,
good for him.
Well. Yeah. On that Williams back then, 2004 or something. But those were the fastest cars that we've seen. Still, 10 years on, 11 years on, and Formula One still hasn't or somehow decided that the fastest cars was not something that they were interested in. Riddle me that.
I think it was to do with the whole safety thing, though, wasn't it? Because they were trying to slow them down because at one point they were going to get too fast and they were going to literally take off. if they got too fast, so they had to slow them down. But it is weird looking at track records and still seeing Schumacher's name and Montoya's name and people like that. But because all you do is you look at the cars now and think, yeah, they're the fastest things that have ever been. When really in reality they're not.
Yeah.
I think GP2 cars are nearly as quick, if not as quick, as Formula One cars as well.
That's
You'd expect a big jump from GP2 to F1 in speed, but they're fairly similar.
But
it's just downforce, I think.
And that's crazy to me. Like I am of the opinion that that shouldn't be.
I think you're right. Yeah, it should be GP2 easy, slow, get to learn F1, you know, a bit more of experience, single seat, and then F1, the elite, top speeds, 200 miles an hour at every corner, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
Jesus. That still blows my mind.
Yeah.
I don't know if you guys know, but so in the beginning of the year, actually, maybe December of last year, Jay and Danny came to me
and they were like, hey, so we know you used to do a podcast back in the day. Would you be willing to do another one? And I was like, okay. And they're like, okay, so we're doing Formula One. And at this point in my life, I had absolutely no history with Formula One, none whatsoever. But throughout the last 3 months or so, since we started this, I've grown a fondness to it, and I wish I knew more about it. And slowly, it's getting there. The appreciation is definitely grown significantly.
It is a road that every single new fan must embark upon. Yeah. Even you two. How did you two get into F1?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, and just for honesty, and that adds another aspect to your podcast, and we quite like that, because we sort of, when we started out, we sort of joked around and said we'll do this hashtag find a fan thing. Mm-hmm. But it's quite nice that you've got someone on your podcast who is going on that journey through, mm-hmm, and learning about Formula One and picking it up for the first time.
I feel like for Frodo.
Sorry, what did you say?
I feel like Frodo Baggins, and I've got my merry band, and we will go drop the ring off to Bernie Ecclestone's butt.
For me though, I was really lucky because my dad was a huge F1 fan, as was my mum, but that's because she fancied the pants off Nigel Mansell, and if she could have taken his mustache off and pickled it, she would have. So I was sort of brought up with it, and we had like little toy cars, and we had pedal go karts, and we were always with Formula One throughout our entire lives. But Ben, because of the whole gap between, with Schumacher dominating, and they had that whole period where it went off and it was getting quite boring, and everyone seemed to tune out.
Yeah.
Ben missed out on the early years, didn't you? And you sort of picked it up a little bit later on.
Yeah, I didn't really follow it early on. I kind of really got into it in 2007 when Hamilton burst on the scene. I even though it's quite recent, I still can't remember a lot about it, but I remember you know Lewis looks like a really good driver, I'll see what comes of it. And then following year, Mark and Daniel, Mark our other brother the eldest, for a Christmas present they said next year 2008 we'll take you to Silverstone.
Nice.
And I was psyched, couldn't wait. And then ever since then I've just been on it, always, everything F1.
That's awesome,
my
man.
Number one sport now.
That's awesome, man. And honestly, I mean, I don't think that the time that you've been following F1 from, or like how long you've been a fan for, really like counts for much, because I've read like your biting points and like it's bang on. Hey, and honestly, like if our listeners out there like haven't checked it out, check out the 5Lights podcast page. You put out a segment, Ben's biting points. It's usually usually pretty bang on.
it's my rants in the world of F1. Put your praise on it.
It's interesting that you say that. So your mother and your father were like into F1, but even if it's not that, being in the UK, you are aware of F1, like as a regular person, it is a sport that people, I'm up there with rugby and football. We're calling it football.
Don't kill me.
You can call it soccer because we're big American football fans. So
oh yeah,
you can call it soccer. It's fine.
but you know what I mean? Like it's a sport that people know about, right? Like up here in Canada, it is actually like it is what you imagine. It is mostly hockey. This is
100%.
This is 100%. Canada,
a bit
is
of baseball, but
hockey. Yeah, hockey, a bit of baseball. Quebec is different. French Canada is different, and they like F1, but they have a long history. The race being in Montreal, and they've had a hero to cheer for in Gilles Villeneuve, and to a certain degree Jacques. But Canada is perhaps F1 is not as big a deal here.
It's not even on the radar
for most people. To be fair,
when I tell my friends that I'm doing an F1 podcast, they're like, "You doing an F1 what?"
Like, what's F1?
I'm like, Formula One. They're like, "But you like that?" And like, it's a weird question mark. And then like, something comes over me, mm-hmm, and I'm like, I wish you understood it the way I see it now. Because before I was like, I don't get it. I just fast cars going around, cool. But until you actually start seeing it and participating in it, you don't understand, like, the respect that of speed that there is. Like, there's something to say. I went to Niagara Falls this weekend, and...
As you do, being in Canada. Yeah,
yeah. You just go to Niagara Falls on the weekend. It's just what you are. Really just any sort of massive water falling off of an edge. That's all you really need. But there's a respect for the speed at which it happens, the amount of which it happens. Yeah. And that's like that respect for speed, you just kind of start accumulating after a while when you watch these races and just seeing how fast they go. And it's mind-blowing. It's really crazy.
And it is hard, and let's be honest, in North America as a whole, it is perhaps not as easy as it is in Europe to be an F1 fan.
Right.
We have to put up with this shitty coverage.
Yeah.
Our local coverage here sucks, and I know that, like, from listening to you guys, like, you guys are pampered in the UK. Because not only do you get the Sky coverage, but you have, if you don't have that, then you get the BBC highlights or live races, depending on what it is. And it is decent. Even the BBC that doesn't do it like fully live all the races, it is a decent coverage. And Sky is like, it's just on a whole nother level. Like, you, I remember, like, one of your past podcasts, you were recommending people to go on the Sky, like, pit lane channel or the team radio channel.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
that sounds amazing.
We are so lucky over here. Yeah. Obviously, BBC had it for a few years where they were the sole broadcaster of Formula One, and they did a brilliant job. And everyone loves the BBC with their coverage of Formula One, because it goes back to, you know, the 80s when they had it before ITV had it in the 90s.
To be honest, I got like every once in a while I put the chain on repeat on my headphones when I'm like, yeah, like, you can't. Yeah. Dun, 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 dun. Oh, anyway, go on.
it's the best baseline in sports. And then when Sky took it over, there was a big sort of furor, and everyone was like, oh, you can't do that. Sky's going to ruin it. But Sky really are the best team for covering any sort of sport, whether it be soccer or, you know, F1 or even the darts. They do good coverage of that. And that's a terrible sport. But
isn't that just like,
begin with?
Isn't that just like fat man, like, getting drunk and like...
yeah. It's just fat man throwing metal darts at a board. It blows my mind how that's a sport. But yeah, I mean, what we have over here is obviously they do the coverage and they cover everything. So they do all the free practices, they have midweek shows, they do all the pre-season testing. That's all on their channel. And then on race days and on qualifying, they have an app. And within the app, you can get the live timings, you can follow certain drivers on board throughout the race. You can say, listen to the pit lane channel. And I like listening to the pit lane channel as well as the main coverage, because you hear so much more that doesn't get broadcast. Especially Hülkenberg last year. Every race, Hülkenberg was having an argument with his engineer, and it never got broadcast. But he came across as such a prima donna last year.
Really?
Yeah. There'd be times where he'd be saying something about another driver, going, oh, he's doing this, he's in my way, he needs to get out of my way, blah, blah, blah. His engineer would come over and go, look, just get on with driving, will you? And just let's get on. And he'd literally talk to him like a child like that. It's like, come on, just get on with it, will you? And that just doesn't get shown on the telly.
For sure. Yeah, no, and over here, we're lucky if we get the race uninterrupted. Honestly, really? Like, they'll cut it off. TSN is the Canadian ESPN.
Sure.
Let's name it that. Whatever, the big sports network. And they have the rights for F1. And what they do is, I guess, the same thing that Setanta does in Ireland, is that they just do the BBC feed. So for commentary or whatever, we get DC and whoever the other dude is. But the thing is that if there's, like... If there's anything, even fucking tennis, if there's anything before the race that goes over its allotted time, it will bite onto so I've watched, and I remember, like, we got together a couple years ago to watch Brazil, 2012, and we went to a bar and we, like, demanded that they put it on the screen. there was tennis going on and it went over the allotted time and it cut in. So by the time that it switched to the race, it was already 5 minutes into the race. Like, so we missed the start. We missed, you know, and that was a big deal because like the start of Brazil 2012 changed many things, or at least it could have.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I mean, I had the same experience when I was in Lithuania. I spent 4 months in Lithuania.
Okay.
And their big sport over there is high soccer as well, and they've got a couple of other big sports I can't remember, but they do the same, so they'll piggyback off other feeds to bring the footage in.
Yeah.
And we were all, there was four of us sat in a bar watching the Formula 1 because it was the only place we could get it, because the internet signal out there was terrible, so we couldn't get it on our tablets or anything. And it was an ice hockey game on, and we were like looking at our watches going, oh, it's alright, they'll just leave this on and then they'll do the ice hockey in a minute. But they cut the feed four laps from the end just to get the pre-game of the hockey, and there was four Brits in there just going, "What are you doing?
Come on!"
Going absolutely nuts because they cut the feed. I can't remember which race. It was the one after Monaco. It was the race after Monaco, and I can't remember off the top of my head now.
Which, sure.
Was it? Yeah, I think it was.
Yeah,
and they cut it out for a hockey game. And but yeah,
are you talking about the Canadian Grand Prix, possibly the best Grand Prix of the whole season? I mean, let's be honest.
Well, Ben, I'll get your thoughts on this as well, because obviously we have favourites. Silverstone's our favourite race because it's our home Grand Prix, and since they've changed the circuit, I don't think there's been a dull race there. But for sheer entertainment value and what the hell's going to happen value, Canada is one of the best Grand Prix, if not the second best, Silverstone Grand Prix on the circuit. Would you not agree?
That's crazy.
I think so.
Yeah, I mean, it's semi street circuit, and I'm, as I've said before in our podcast, I'm not a fan of street circuits, but it's wide enough and it's long enough to be able to allow overtaking and dramatic racing, mm-hmm. as we saw, like, I think 2011 when Jensen Button,
that a fantastic drive all the way from the back.
I think he pitted five times and was at the back, mm-hmm. as you say, and he won, but you had the rain as well. It was about a 4 hour long race, and it's just all the races there are, as Dan said, are great, really.
To me, that was Jensen's last like truly great performance. Like, truly, like if Jensen ever got considered like one of the greats of the sport, that would be like a big point on his resume, so to speak.
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. I mean, that race, because we had that sort of, was it 2 hour rain delay? Or something ridiculous. It was really long. I was in Norfolk, and I was due to drive back to Cottesmore, which is in the middle of the country. So it's about a 2 hour drive that night. But I said, no, I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying put because I want to watch this Grand Prix. And I ended up staying the night and then driving back the next morning. But I wouldn't have done that for any other Grand Prix, really, because if it had been Monaco, I'd have just gone, doesn't matter, because you're not going to get the action that you do at Montreal. And going on to Jensen Button, he is a great driver. He's one of the best British drivers, I think, that we've seen in certainly in the last 10, 15 years. And yes, that's probably his last great performance, but he's consistently very, very good. And if you want a driver, especially with McLaren in the state they are now, where they've got trouble with their engine and the development, if you want a driver who is going to stick by you loyally and also do a good job and give you the performance that you need, I think Jensen Button is the driver you'd go to, because if you put Lewis Hamilton in that car, you know that he would be complaining, because he's obviously he's got a different edge about him. He's a more edgier driver, whereas Jensen Button can see the wood for the trees and go, right, okay, so it's bad now, but I'm at the end of my career, and I want to drive Formula One cars, and there's no better place to be for me right now than McLaren.
And I think that it's commendable that he's stuck around. He takes pride in being an all British driver, and he's in the all British team.
How old is he?
He's up there in his
30s. 34, I think.
Yeah,
making him
35.
Making him for some reason one of the senior figures in the paddock.
What's the lifespan of an F1 driver?
Oh man, that's a subject of high discussion right now. I'll leave it to the five guys. Excuse me for a second, but I will let you expand on that.
Yeah, I think at the moment, Kimi Raikkonen is the eldest. He's 35. I think he's only a few months older than Kimi Raikkonen, than Jensen Button, sorry. But as we've seen now with like Max Verstappen, who's
a kid,
for God's sake, he's younger than I am. Yeah. He's 17, and that makes me feel old, and I'm not even old. So it varies much more nowadays. But in like sports, like say American football, I'm not sure about hockey and soccer in this country. Once you hit your 30s, that's kind of, you know, think about settling down and retiring.
Right.
But in Formula One, that's when you're kind of in your prime.
Interesting.
The best drivers tend to be 30 onwards, as we see now with Lewis Hamilton. He's just won one. He's 30 now. I think Michael Schumacher and would have won some in his 30s, possibly. Damon Hill, he didn't even start Formula One, I think, until he was 27, and he won a championship. So yeah, between 30 and 35 is when Formula One drivers tend to hit their prime, probably because of their experience, I would assume.
Yeah.
It differs greatly now because the physical challenges on the drivers are completely different to what they were even 10 years ago. And you've got the whole video game generation.
Right,
so, right.
That's me.
Yeah, well, exactly. I mean, I stink at the Formula One game. I'm terrible at it. Absolutely okay. Awful. So I would be an awful Formula One driver by that logic. But yeah, I mean, the span changes because it's not as physical as it used to be.
Right.
So say if you were in sort of Nigel Mansell's era, the cars were a lot more physically demanding, and you also had the risk of losing your life back in the early 90s especially. Right. So you know it changed. So I mean, I don't think it'll be too long until we see a driver pushing 40 maybe going for it. I mean, we have, was Barrichello what, 36, 38 when he called it a day?
Schumacher. No, 40 Barrichello, Rubinho was like, well, he was still racing when he was 41, man.
41, that's, yeah. So, yeah. So I think that'll be so you've proven my point already.
Yeah.
So, I think that will become the norm. As long as you've got the talent.
I've heard that, you know, it can come and go, you know, sometimes like the philosophy is like, oh, you know, we need younger drivers, but then they're like, okay, well, no, then we need more experience. After I guess the younger driver experiment fails, but throw in the huge wrench in the system that has been Max Verstappen, and now that's got it. I think that Max Verstappen has got everybody scratching their heads.
Yeah. Well, Ben, I'm going to let you out because I'm going to turn my light on because I'm really dark.
Yeah,
he, as you said, he's kind of an anomaly. But as Dan also said, with the video game generation and also the fact that his father was a Formula One driver, Jos Verstappen, he's grown up in that world. So it's he doesn't really know anything else. He's grown up in that bubble. He's used to the media attention from watching his father being interviewed. He did karting. He obviously had, his dad had the money to send him karting. But even in like the 90s and 80s, there were still 18, 19 year olds testing, obviously not driving and competing in the races, but they were still testing. It's less physically demanding now to be a Formula One driver. And I'm not really sure that's not necessarily a bad thing, as long as it's competitive and it still requires a great amount of skill, which it does, because you've got to press all those buttons, you've got to be talking at the same time. It's quite complicated mentally. But on the other end of the spectrum, with the hitting 30 onwards, once people retire from Formula One, or even if they're not in Formula One, motorsport and racing drivers, they drive well into their 40s, even touching 50s. And a lot of people win championships, especially like Le Mans in 24 hours. They win it in their 40s.
Martin Brundle is like he raced a Le Mans last year.
Yeah.
With his son. Mm-hmm. And they did pretty well. And Alan McNish, Scottish driver, he's won Le Mans 3 times, I think.
Yeah.
And I think he did that twice in his 40s. So there's no kind of set prime.
I think there's two things that are gonna make people leave the sport. One is not so much physical fitness, but mental fitness. As Ben said, with all the buttons on the steering wheel, at what point then, because obviously there's a lot of other motorsports where it's a lot simpler than that. But you've got so many things to remember in Formula One, it's gonna be your mental capacity. And the other thing is from a marketing perspective. So from a team's perspective, are they going to want to market a 40-year-old driver? You know, they're going to want to look for someone new who they can follow through, who's going to be probably a bit more savvy on Twitter and things like that, who can push their brand. So it's all about branding as well now, especially when you're a team
huge.
Football, you know.
Yeah, and one thing interesting to that point that I still find, like, it still reverberates in my head all the time. journalist extraordinaire, F1 journalist extraordinaire, Joe Sayward. He was quoted saying something like, "Grands Prix are big events, and Formula One is a big event, and winning a Grand Prix should require big skill." Now, to add to that, I'd say, yeah, whether that skill comes, you know, in the past, it has come as like actually being able to like wrestle the car around the corners back before power steering and all that, or now how it is like more of like a mental game and like and being able to like think your moves ahead and think you're overtaking like 2 or 3 or 10 corners ahead. It should still require ultimate skill. Like, mm-hmm. you and I should never get the impression that that we could be Formula One drivers, right?
Hold on a second.
No, but you know what I mean. Like if I got into a Formula One car, I would. Well, first of all, I couldn't. You'd have to just fucking rub it all with Vaseline and somewhere. But but if I got into a Formula One car, it would just be bad news.
Yeah.
But
no, I'd be scared just looking at it.
Yeah.
But that picture in the background. Terrified.
Yeah, but it should be that it should require ultimate skill. Now, what that ultimate skill is, then yeah, that has changed mm-hmm. over the years. But it doesn't mean that it isn't ultimate skill.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think.
Yeah, I don't know. Whether, do you get Top Gear over there?
Oh yeah. Well,
it's, yeah. There was.
Well, not anymore.
There
was,
well, yeah, yeah. Fuck Top Gear now.
No one does that anymore. Richard Hammond did that thing a few years ago where he drove the Renault F1 car, didn't he? And he sort of worked his way up through all the different formulas and mm-hmm. things like that. And obviously he was great in like the Ariel Atom and all the other supercars that are road going.
Yeah.
But when he got to the Renault F1 car, he was bricking it because you have to go fast mm-hmm. to make the car work. And then obviously when you're going fast, your brain has to work a lot faster. Mm-hmm. So there's obviously, you have to be talented to be able to drive. You have to have that sort of 20/20 vision and be able to see everything that's going on. You have to have great mental capacity. You have to be physically fit, and you have to see things a hell of a lot quicker than everybody else. And you could just see that from him driving around the Top Gear track, that it's a completely different ball game from driving, say, your F40 on the road on the motorway at 80-90 miles an hour.
Adding to that, Sky Sports, they tagged along Silverstone yesterday because Force India did a filming day. And Martin Brundle was there, and he actually drove this year's Force India car.
Really?
And I think he actually binned it into the wall.
Oh, shit.
Because there's not a lot of grip on the car. So he was going too fast, and he hit the wall. I don't think that fast, but it proves that even from when he was driving, it's completely different. It's less physical, and it's more to do with aerodynamics now than it ever was.
And that's cool. I would like to take the discussion. Sorry, Mike.
Yeah, go for
actually,
it.
No, jump in.
Sorry, I just want to say that video, that one you were talking about, changed my whole perspective on F1 racing.
Yeah,
entirely.
This is something that we did sort of early on when we were trying to explain or at least offer Mike some sort of appreciation. We showed him that clip from Top Gear when Hammond went like up the categories, and yeah, you get to and you know, this is Richard Hammond. He's been driving supercars around hypercars. He's a big fan of the Zonda, and I'm sure driving a Zonda is ridiculous, and I would probably crash it in 2 seconds. But even he mm-hmm. can't like he couldn't handle it. He couldn't handle an F1 car.
And that's where like the respect.
Or even the lower formula he was having problems with.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. And that's where like the respect for speed and like velocity and how fast you go, like, and I was like, oh my god, this is way crazier than I could even imagine.
Yeah. So what I was gonna say, I want to just take the discussion away from F1 specifically okay. related toppings. Toppings. I said toppings. I meant topics.
We're talking about pizzas. Let's do this.
Yeah. So Dan, our Dan, he says to you too. He tells it. Okay, so he says, tell them we've spoken. So I've spoken with him, and he offers his regrets for not being here. Nice. Hopefully we can do this another time and when he's around. But that he promises he will continue to kick your asses in fantasy.
What a piece of work.
Right. It's been great working with you fellas.
Well, he's run away, so yeah, I don't really take that seriously if he's not there.
Yeah, what a coward.
Yeah. I'm catching him anyway, so.
What he's done is the equivalent of when you're a kid in a playground, he's running up to someone, punching him in the arm, and then running off. So thanks for that. Yeah, good. Ben's not too far behind, though. I think we said 24 points last time.
I'm catching him. He didn't do too well last race, I don't think.
Yeah, because we got drunk that night and forgot to do our picks.
Right. So if you keep sending over like loads of alcohol and say get you drunk before every race, then we'll walk away with it.
You'll win right away.
If it makes anyone feel better, I picked randomly and I'm beating Javier. So
yay!
Because I let my heart do the picking.
Alonso,
I picked Alonso, and I'm a big Alonso fan. Guys, I set an alarm on my phone when we started, and it has been past the half an hour mark. I've had a lot of fun. I want to keep hanging out. Are you guys still cool or like what?
Yeah, we can do. Yeah, we can do a little bit more. Yeah, we're happy. Yeah. My children are in bed now, so it's fine.
Well, that certainly helps.
Great, I got a surprise beer.
I don't have a bedtime anymore now. I'm 20, so I'm still good.
cool. I want to talk about now F1 news and what's been going. The news, and what's been happening. Since Bahrain, and one thing. I mean, I wanted to bring up the whole Hamilton. Have you seen that picture of Hamilton in his boxer briefs?
No.
Yes. Oh,
probably should have said that.
Don't look
it
up.
Such excitement, though, Ben. She's like, "Yes, I have." Yeah.
I'm a big Hamilton guy. So.
What did you think about that?
that's who Hamilton is. Really, he's a big superstar. So as well as being a Formula One driver, he's the model. He's always in magazines and things like that. It's just
Hopefully we'll hear some of his music soon and judge his talent. But he's apparently going to be in the Zoolander 2 movie.
No way.
Yeah. He has a cameo in the Zoolander. It is unclear yet whether or not he has a speaking role. But there's pictures of him in the set with Ben Stiller and stuff. So, look.
I've got an image now of like at the end of both Hangover movies when Mike Tyson comes on and does the rap. Maybe that's what Hamilton's going to come on and start performing his songs at some sort of random party somewhere, showcasing his music.
Probably.
But does Roscoe get a?
Yo, well, where is Roscoe in all this?
Is Roscoe going to get a cameo? This is the thing.
What I want to know is he has two dogs. I don't know what happens to Coco. Why does Coco not get the limelight as well?
Okay, maybe that was the Coles.
Coco is like the Rosberg of No, but now in a more serious note, one thing that I just read actually just before coming here was that you know who Tobias Gruner is?
I know the name.
Yeah. He's a reporter from the German Automotor und Sport magazine, and he's reporting now on a recent story, something that the Max Mosley just said, and he said that his solution to F1 cost ridiculousness that's happening, his cost saving idea is a voluntary budget cap, whereby the teams that sign on to this voluntary spending cap, they get more technical freedom. Or something like, you know, if you agree to not spend that much money, then you can get away with like certain things in the aero and with the tokens maybe. I think that's interesting, and that is a very Max Mosley thing to say as well.
Yeah, I think it's going to be very difficult for the teams to get on board with that, especially. I can see where he's coming from. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of teams would obviously like the extra technical freedom, but I don't think really that it's going to level the playing field any, because you're still going to have the teams at the bottom who, it depends where the voluntary cap is as well. So if you've got, say, the top teams who have a voluntary cap of, you know, let's say, I know it's just well below the line, but say 20 million or whatever like that. Yeah. And then the bottom teams like Marussia can only afford to spend 20 million anyway.
Right.
You know, where does the line get drawn on where this cap is going to be? And then obviously the bigger teams have got the better technical minds anyway, so they're always going to be there.
And the facilities, right? Like the tunnels and whatnot.
Absolutely. Ben, I don't know what your thoughts on that are.
Well, Williams, in other news, Williams have just reported a loss of £34 million or something like that.
Oh, my God.
And that's because they finished ninth in 2013. And obviously, that's not large prize money. And then they decided halfway during 2013, let's revamp ourselves. Let's move everything elsewhere. Let's get in new people. And that's cost them a lot of money. And hence the £34 million loss. They can afford to do that. But like Daniel said, Man of Mauritia, Force India, Sauber, and even Lotus, they can't really afford to do that. And teams don't, the F1 teams don't really like to be told what they can spend. They want this, 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 and this, but they're not prepared to sacrifice things like a budget cap or anything like that. And the thing that frustrates me about Formula One, and as far as I'm aware, it's the sport that does it, it's a sport that's dictated to by the teams.
Right.
They make their own rules, which is fine, but teams are going to pull towards their own camp and say, we want this rule because it suits us, not we want this rule because it suits Formula One as a whole.
A quote from Ted Kravitz that he said, it's like right now the way that Formula One is that it's like children voting on how many candies they can get. You know what I mean? Like, it is a certain way like that, and that's why I like as much as Mosley got criticized in his years. He was at least a strong presence in the FIA, and he had the power behind him, and he had enough strength to actually go up to the teams and offer some controversial regulations for the better of the sport. Some of it worked, some of it didn't. But the thing is that right now in the FIA, which is supposed to be, at least on paper, the regulatory body, the you know what I mean? The because there's the teams over here that, you know, what they want, who knows, and they can never agree on anything. And there's supposed to be the FIA on the other end, opposite to both that and the commercials right holder, to balance that, to balance and to bring a level head, and that in a way that was what a mostly like figure should have been doing. But Jean Todt is doing absolutely not. He's just taking the money in and letting them do what they want to do, and that is not the right way to. Since the beginning of the year, I spent many, many days just researching on how the F1 strategy group actually works and reading a lot about that. And even though they have like maybe like the right ideas sometimes, like with the bringing more spectacle to Formula One, you can tell that it's a like the fact that it exists is a bad idea to begin with, because it's like you have these teams, and it's not all the teams, it's the top six teams and plus Bernie in cahoots trying to figure out like how to basically get more money out of a sport that is dying, and it's their fault that it's dying.
Should be the FIA saying this is how it's going to be done, you've got to do it this way, you've got to do it that way, and not the team saying we want this, we want that. Like we've had a Red Bull at the beginning of the season complaining because, you know, putting the blame at Renault's door because they had a poor engine and saying we want this, we want that. And now I think they've only just agreed in Malaysia that they've added an additional power unit to the year's total. So they did have four at the start of the season to use. They now have five. And I think all teams unanimously agreed on that. So they've increased that. But it shouldn't be to the teams to say, yes, they should have input, like the fans should have input.
Probably
say that again in a minute. But the FIA should say, yeah, we take your point from the teams, we take the fans' point, we'll combine them together, and this is how it will be.
We said this a couple of weeks ago on one of our podcasts as well, that Christian Horner looks like he's the one who's being groomed by Bernie to step into the fold when Bernie goes. And I said at the time, I think Ben agreed, that it's a bad idea that you get another team principal to step into that role. What it should be, as you said with Max Mosley, yes, he was a controversial figure, but he was not an F1 figure. He was an outside businessman. And I think sometimes you just need someone from the outside who has maybe run a sport or a sports team, but has no affiliation necessarily to Formula One, who can see it from an outside perspective rather than being on the pit wall. Because as, if Christian Horner becomes what Bernie is now, how is, and Red Bull is still in the sport, how does he not have any sort of favoritism towards Red Bull?
Absolutely.
It wouldn't work.
But it goes beyond that, because, you know, and this is not just F1. This is happening all around the world right now with many industries and especially any kind of entertainment industry right now. That was built and came to fruition in the rogue days of the 70s.
Right.
They honed their talent in the 80s, but it was all about like schmoozing and backroom dealing and like just being like really fucking skeevy all the while, and like, you know, you take care of me, I take care of you.
Right.
And but the thing is that in a way is just not how the world works right now.
Right.
And we have these dinosaurs at the top that are refusing to see that the world has changed and there's a new reality. Right. And they still want to be attached to that old way of doing things.
You almost don't want to, you know, build an industry on dinosaur bones, right?
Yeah.
Something I've noticed when Javier and Danny have sort of got me into Formula One, it's like it does seem very archaic in the sense of how management is done and how people interact with each other. It seems very like, so like I grew up in Toronto, but there's an area of Toronto that called like Little Italy, and a lot of old Italian families are there, and it gives off that same vibe where it's like, hey man, this is my cousin, he does this, he's a mason, he works here, he works there. Let me bring him in.
Hey, he'll, Johnny, come over here. Come over here, Dad. Come Johnny. Yeah.
Yeah. And there's a lot of things happening in the background that.
Ma, where's the lasagna?
And it's not there. It's my hope that this sport can sort of through technology and communication sort of illuminate that. That stuff that doesn't need to be there.
But let the
sport work itself out, and not let it try to be directed necessarily by a few people.
And here's the main barrier that I think that is facing is that the people at the top, and I don't know if you guys agree with me or not, but the people at the top are not going to see it that way until there is like a big collapse. But can Formula One actually survive a big collapse? You know what I mean? What if everybody just stops watching F1 for a little bit? Will it recover from that? Will they actually be place themselves in a situation where there's no turning back?
Well, this is, I mean, our auntie, Karin, she used to be anyway, a massive Formula One fan, and that was down to the fact that Schumacher was there. So everyone followed Schumacher. Now that crowd's starting to go now because Schumacher's left.
Right.
If you look at F1 crowds on average, especially if you watch the F1 show on Sky Sports, a lot of the audience tends to be of the older generation. So there's going to come a point where obviously the younger generation aren't coming through. So there needs to be something done. I mean, the YouTube channel, for example, they've had it for donkey's years. Apparently, I think it's 4 or 5 years or something like that, and they've never used it, and they've only just started using it.
Just recently,
They've
been listening to our podcast.
And it's one of your main outputs is YouTube. You know, everyone's on YouTube, and everyone watches. It's like the NFL; they only just got a YouTube channel. But I do like the fact that I do like the NFL model, because there's always a different team at the top of NFL. Yes, you have the teams who are sort of always there, but there's always somebody else in the mix. So whether I'm not involved, but whether everyone can look at other sports as a model and see how they're becoming successful and how they mix things up. And even go back to sort of the early 90s and the 80s, yes, obviously you've got the whole you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours thing, so we need to eliminate that. But look at the model of why F1 worked then and why it was competitive. But there's always been team domination. So I don't think you can even blame it on sort of Schumacher dominating or Red Bull dominating for the fans to go away. There's something inherently wrong with F1 as to why people don't tune in and why people find it a boring sport, and that's something that they need to look at.
But I want to put something out, though. I don't find F1 a boring sport.
No.
And despite, like, I think when many people, like, from the outside, if you're starting to get into F1 right now, obviously, if you're a new fan,
that's me.
Yeah.
That's me.
Yeah.
I'm getting into it right now.
Yeah, but if you just out of your own volition, let's say one day you were bored and, like, stumbled upon an F1 thread on Reddit or whatever, and decided to give the sport a chance and check it out. It's hard to do that, like, number one, on your own, like, because right now, like, you might be confronted with, like, many things that seem to not make sense. Like, how is if you tune in, like, to any kind of commentary this year, you're gonna be like, eventually you're gonna hear about how there's teams, like you said, Marussia struggling for money. Actually, anybody from, like, the bottom half of the grid, they're all struggling for money. Mm-hmm. Caterham is not a team anymore. Or what? Caterham? Caterham is not a team anymore. And even though it was because of mismanagement and whatnot, but still, I mean, if you're gonna be in F1, and there used to be a point in F1 history where all of the teams made money, and that's the point. This happened in the 80s and whatnot. Everybody was making money because the sport was working. Because
at that time,
yeah, and it's not that they didn't have more viewership than they do now, because it was Europe plus a few others that watched it. They didn't have, like, anywhere like the amount of sponsorship money that's coming in, but every team was profitable to a certain degree. And even Williams, there was one point where Williams was, like, the reigning world champion for, what, 2 or 3 years in a row?
Yeah.
I mean, I've been a hardcore fan since 2007. Mm-hmm. And I love it to bits. It's my favorite sport. And I'll watch everything that I can, practice, race, qualifying, and everything else in between. And you get the occasional race, like, say, China or Australia. You speak to people, like, at work, school, college, wherever, and so I was bored, I fell asleep. It's rubbish. And it annoys me because it's not. And they're expecting, you know, massive overtakes, crashes. That's the main one. Everyone expects a massive crash. And it's not what the sport's about. Mm-hmm. And we've seen, like, with Germany now losing its race because of people not wanting to go. But in Italy and Germany now, their audiences are building back up again because of Sebastian Vettel and Ferrari. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the main thing to do with viewership, is just one driver or one team. People just want to be loyal to one thing. They want to support something and put their support in someone or a group. And I suppose it's just a pattern that will occur. You know, now Hamilton's time at the moment, so all the Brits are going to be on Hamilton, and then before it was Sebastian Vettel, so it was all the Germans and probably less Brits. So I suppose it's a pattern there as well.
How good is it that Ferrari is back at the top? Let's be honest.
Can I just chime in for one second as one of those outside views? It feels to me that F1 is it's definitely an older sport, and not talking like soccer. No,
there's a burden of history there for sure.
It is, yeah. But to me, in the life of the YouTube and, you know, the sort of the upvote land and all these sort of things, like, the spectacle of going really fast isn't really that impressive anymore. And I think it's something to say about the generation. It's like, you know, well, just show me the fastest thing that crashes. You know, people aren't attracted. Like, people are more attracted to the explosions than they are, you know, the finesse that it sort of takes to drive around a corner. And it sucks because there is definitely an art here.
Oh, for sure.
And I would love to see it continue, but unless something changes in the sport.
You know what? Okay, so this is extremely morbid but going back to Joe Sayward, one of his opinions, and I don't want to be like you know, misrepresented in
this. Don't put a curse on someone.
Yeah, no, but no, I don't want to be either misquoted or misrepresented here. But I agree with, I don't agree 100% with what he's saying, but I agree with like the general idea. But anyway, Joe Sayward has said that maybe F1 just needs like a good old death. Maybe somebody needs to die, and like, you know what I mean? Like maybe that's what would rescue the sport somehow. And I don't want any of the drivers to go and get killed on the track, but the last time that we had somebody die was Senna.
Yeah.
And
well, we had the Jules Bianchi accident, didn't we, last year?
Right.
And I said, it's not looking good from the reports that are coming out from him that he's actually going to make a full recovery. I don't think the sport necessarily needs a death. I don't think it needs that. I think I read a really good post by the F1 Taxi, at F1 Taxi on Twitter, and he wrote an open letter to Bernie Ecclestone. And he made a really good point about accessibility to the fans. Mm-hmm. We over here, as you said, we're spoilt with what we've got with Sky Sports coverage and things like that, and access to tablets and things. But you guys over there, you don't have that.
Legally.
I don't know what other countries have. But if you're going to grow a sport internationally, then you need to give everybody the same access.
Yes.
And you need to lower the one thing that Bernie Ecclestone needs to get a grip of, and it's the reason why the German Grand Prix is gone, is I don't know what he's charging for countries to hold an F1 race, but it's got to be astronomical.
Tune of 40 million, give or take a couple million on either end.
Which is why ticket prices are so astronomically high, and why we're losing great races like Germany. Because if you look at the world economy, like especially the Italian economy, how long are they going to be able to afford to keep Monza? And you don't want to be seeing classic races like that, because they only get disappear because they only get replaced by these new street circuits that last with what,
nobody
2 years?
With nobody on the stands. And I don't want I didn't have any problem with Bahrain with the race that just passed, except for, you know, in those long shots when you show the stands and there's nobody there, I'm like, you know what, if that was just closer to here, I'd be there. You know, like but
yeah, I mean we get it at Silverstone, you have to arrive at Silverstone at 6 o'clock in the morning to get where you want to sit. If you arrive any time after 6 o'clock in the morning, you're stuffed, because you won't get a seat anywhere, because it's rammed, and it's one of the very few circuits where you can actually sit all the way around the circuit.
Nice.
And it's packed. It's absolutely heaving every year. I mean, I'm not going this year, and I didn't get to go last year, but every year I've been, I went 8 years on the trot, and it got busier and busier every year. And I think Montreal's the same. When you look at the shots of Montreal, the grandstands are always full, always rammed with people.
I think over the past couple of years, like, it's the attendance record has been broken like every year.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I went to Silverstone last year, and as Dan said, we were having to queue to get in. It was so busy, but the prices are astronomical. For me, last year I went general admission 3 days, and it cost me, is it £175 per person for that? And I had a colleague at work, he went to Spa, and he went to Spa, had his ticket, his accommodation, which was camping, the ferry across the channel, all his food, his fuel, the rental. That cost him altogether less than it cost me and my girlfriend to actually get into the circuit.
Oh my God.
And it's just ridiculous.
Wow.
And actually, no, I lived in Spain for about a year and a half. My parents lived there. But when I was there, I did look all this up, and because I wanted to go to the European races, and I was comparing ticket prices, and I don't know if it's still the same way, but if you went for the cheapest tickets for Silverstone, they were still more expensive than the cheapest tickets for Monaco. And I was like, wow, that's insane. But then obviously there's other things. Like it includes the camping, right? Like you gotta
Some of them do. I mean, usually whenever I've been, we've got general admission tickets, which means you go into there and you can sort of go wherever you want. You don't get a grandstand seat, but you get to sit on a bank. And then we pay for camping and everything on top of that. The reason I do that is because we're snobs and we don't like camping. so we camp further away with all the posh people and then driving. but we are being quite negative here about the sport. We do it because we love it, don't we, really?
Right,
that's why we
buy
the tickets. Because it's an awesome sport. I mean, if I could afford to do it, I'd go every year. And if they offered some sort of season ticket where you could go for, you could secure your ticket for 5 years and I could afford to do it, I'd definitely do it. Because you can't beat the atmosphere of a Formula One race. And I think football matches and NFL games and all sorts of sporting
events. It's different.
Yeah, it's different.
Because it's a weekend, right? Like you're the weekend at the races. And it's awesome. And it's a whole day thing, but you love every minute of it. I don't think there's gonna be a year in my recent in my future
foreseeable future
where I'm not gonna go to the Canadian Grand Prix and I'm there from Thursday to Monday because it's the whole thing and the whole experience and the whole atmosphere and it's great and I'm glad this is the first year and we're gonna take Mike with us
so
yeah he's gonna get to experience the race for the first time. Your mind will be blown every second of it.
I feel it already.
But
is there any particular corner at Montreal? I mean, when I took Ben for the first time, it used to be the old layout of the circuit. There used to be the bridge and the cars used to zip underneath this bridge and then take an immediate right hand turn.
The old layout.
And you could hear the cars coming from the other side of the circuit and then they ripped through underneath the tunnel. So you got that echo. It used to vibrate through your chest and then they used to turn away from you, change gear. So you get the explosion of the changing gear through your chest as well. Is there any, and we always, that's the first place I ever stood and that's the first place we took Ben when he went. Is there anywhere in Montreal where you're going to take Mike and say, look, you've got to see the cars coming through here?
So there's actually...
I know a turn I want to see.
Obviously, the hairpin, in and around the hairpin, there's good grandstands there, and there's also a good general admission area around it, and you can. And it was my first going to the races F1 experience on the Sunday when I went. Obviously, this was back in like when the engines were really really loud, I do remember that. Like obviously, so the race started. And it took him, half a minute to 45 seconds to get to the hairpin. But before it did, and before all the cars came, like it was like a wall of sound that was like coming closer and closer, and you could feel it, and you could feel it in your chest, like you said, and then with the downshift, it was so good. It was the greatest, and then they accelerate all the way up, right? Because that's one of the very cool parts of Montreal is that like the hairpin is all the way down to 60 kilometers. Well, I think they go like around at 60 or 80 kilometers. An hour and then go all the way back up. That was intense. There's also the back straight, so to speak. That is the way that you go into the track of Montreal. That's the first thing that you see. Like you kind of go in that way, and if you go like mid race or mid practice, like you just see the cars going like as fast as they can go, and that is like it's a blur in the eyes. You can't really see it. Another cool place is that that fast left
or the chicane.
The chicane and the world championship. There is another general admission area around there, and. There you really like you don't get to see, like you don't get as much of like the downshift in your chest experience, but you do get to see like how it's almost like it almost doesn't seem real how these cars can corner, you know what I mean, like because they're like whoa, 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 you know, like,
they look, I mean obviously when you see them on telly they look quite big, but they're so much smaller in real life when you see them. But there's we went and stood at Maggots and Beckett's, didn't we, a few years ago.
Oh my god, all time like corners of F1, the Maggots Beckett's complex, Mike, it's the best. Like
it's incredible bit of engineering to get the cars go through there. But you actually get to go in a general admission, you get to stand really close to where they're going. And like the Lotus was going through there a couple of years ago and you had the sparks coming up. But you don't realise just how fast they're going through there. And you just think, you look at the circuit, you think, there's no way he's going to go around that corner. And he just goes, whoop, and he's gone. He's like, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And it's like no effort to him. Like, you watch him on board, and it's like, yeah, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, oh.
I was going to mention that when we went there, Dan, because that was also on the old engines as well.
Yeah.
And because we were quite close, I remember we went there for a practice session, and they were screaming past, and the practice session finished, and I turned to Dan, and all I saw was his lips moving. I could not hear a word he was saying. I was completely deaf. I don't know, Jay, if you went to Montreal last year.
Yeah.
I've what do you think of the noise of the new cars?
I thought it wasn't as bad as I thought it was. You know what I mean? Like, I went into it expecting way less, but then I was like, oh, decent. In the sense that before, like with the previous engines, I had to like wear earplugs. If I was gonna stand like anywhere near the track. And after, I could just, you know, I had no earplugs, and the sound level, the noise level was the same. But obviously there were some times back in the V8 days where like you would go like this, you know, like every once in a while it's like, I'm gonna tempt faith now. and it is like the loudest thing that you will ever hear an F1 car, and it was cool. And I think it was actually back then, it was DeResta. DeResta's you know, I think on his first tour on the Force India, he was going down like just speeding up after the hairpin, and his car backfired, and like I felt the shockwave of his car backfiring, like hit me like all, like in my face, like in all my body. Like it's intense, man.
that was one of the things that hit me the first time. When they change gear, it's a punch in the chest.
Yeah.
As they change gear, and it makes such a loud bang.
Yeah.
And it's not something that you can see on the telly, but one of the things I quite like about the new noise levels is that you can hear the car skidding along the ground.
Yes.
You can hear the tires turning when they lock up, and you can hear the gear shifts. You can hear all the mechanics going.
You can hear the driver working.
Yeah, yeah, and I quite like that. It's a different aspect. It's not the same high-pitched noise that we love, and the high-octane.
The scream of science.
Yes, yeah.
The turbo whine is really good to hear as well, the way it just whines, especially as it's going through a corner where it just winds down and then picks up all of a sudden.
Yeah.
It's a really great sound, and I listen to the radio during qualifying practice and the race, and yeah, I can actually hear that over the car, which I like. But it's a completely different sound to the V8s and V10s.
Oh yeah,
I think it's much more of a grunt, and I think it's a much better sound. And it's just, you know, I don't obviously get the pain in my ears now from listening to the V8s, where you know you can't hear after the weekend.
Right.
But speaking of things like hitting you as well, the first year I went, it was me, Daniel, our eldest brother, Mark, and his girlfriend, and we sat at the bridge complex. I remember Force India came past, and he went through, and then under the bridge, turned right. I remember Mark, our eldest brother, he went, oh, what was that? And he was looking down at his coat, and then one of the marbles had flipped off the tire and hit him. Bang.
What? Oh my god. Oh my god.
We got
god.
Three or four that year, didn't we? Because we were like collecting them. It was like almost raining at some point. We're like, well, this is the one. And we're like collecting these big bits of rubber, like really pliable bits. We're like, look at this.
Yeah.
And just putting these bits together. But
yeah, isn't it crazy how soft they actually are? Like,
yeah,
it's,
yeah.
And they don't smell. They don't smell. Yeah. I was kind of impressed because I after the race last year, actually, Danny and I climbed over the wall, and like we tried to race. We tried to race.
You weren't
to
that
go
guy in China, were you?
No, no. But we tried to go all the way to obviously to see the podium ceremony, but we were sitting at the hairpin. So obviously, like, no. By the time we got there, we were hopeless, and it was like I think it was the hottest day that in Montreal. So okay, we were sweating buckets all day and really really stoned. And so we didn't make it there. We only made it to when we got to see Danny Ricciardo posing with his team, like just like his first victory, right? That was last year. in Canada. But we just got to see like the picture when they were like taking like, you know, with the whole team and whatever and like the prizes. We didn't get to see any of the podium ceremony. Like that's how long it took to actually get down. But on the way down, we collected a bunch of the marbles. And yeah, man, it's like you expect like you're like you know how tires smell.
Yeah,
they don't. Like,
well, Dan lift one on our very first podcast. So yeah, I do know.
Well, no, but like F1 tires don't really.
Yeah,
yeah, for some reason. Because it's mostly plastic, I guess, what they use now.
It's a weird one because it was the first year a few years ago where they actually started letting people on the track at Silverstone. So, we collected loads. But the other thing that's quite funny is when you get people on the track, it's amazing what they try and get away with. Like, we'll have this sign off here and we'll try and rip up this bit here. It's like, wait, how do you think you're going to get away with that? How do you think you're going to get out of the circuit carrying that sign?
Maybe if I put it in my coat.
Yeah, we can see you've got that. It's not, you're not inconspicuous at all. But yeah, I mean, Those are the little things that I think F1 needs to do a lot more is give better access. Even if they open the track on a Thursday, I mean, obviously that's going to incur a cost. But they did it last year, didn't they, Ben? They opened it the pitch on a Thursday.
When I went last year, because it was the 50th anniversary of Silverstone, if you had a three-day ticket, regardless if it was grandstand or general admission, on the Thursday they had two sessions where they opened up the pit lane and it was, well, I say free entry, but you didn't have to pay extra on top of your normal ticket price. So right. You could just go along there. You had to queue for quite a while, but you were just allowed to walk along the pit lane. And me and my girlfriend thought, yeah, we're definitely doing that. And it was amazing that you got to see all the cars were prepared, all the engineers were setting up, the pit crew were there doing their stuff. Saw Guido van der Garde.
Excuse me, I'm sure you mean Guido van der Garde.
Guido van der Garde, sorry.
Wow. apparently that's how you pronounce it. I looked it up. It sounds like anyway, go on. Sorry, man.
You know, we're not very good at pronunciations anyway. We're terrible with names.
We're very bad.
Good old Guido, whatever his name is.
There was drivers all around, test drivers. And then when I think we got to the end of the pit lane, the Checo Perez was coming in from his bike ride.
Cool.
Jock Clear, who was at the time Lewis Hamilton's race engineer, he came out with his steering wheel and was showing everyone. You could look at it, take pictures. And then as I left, you had to cross the main pit straight to go back in towards a grandstand. And I saw some, like a huddle and on the last corner. And I said to my girlfriend who was with me, I said, I think I know who that is. As we got closer and there was more people starting to have the same kind of thoughts that I was, and it was Nigel Mansell.
Oh, what?
So all these people, including myself, just started swarming towards this corner with their books and pens out, and he just came along and started talking to everyone, and I managed to actually get his autograph. I think I was the second to last autograph that he signed.
Did he have the mustache back on?
No, he was clean shaven, which is quite disappointing. I found it and managed to pickle it somehow. It's just things like that they need to do more often because fans love it.
Let me ask you a question, and I'm serious about this. When are you coming to see the Canadian Grand Prix? we'd be happy to host. I'm putting it out there.
Do it.
If you guys come, to see the Canadian Grand Prix. Can stay with us. There you go.
I've got a wish list of races that I want to go see, and Canada is top of that, and Spa is second, and Monza is third. They're the top three. They're the three races I want to go and see. And if I could hop on a plane tomorrow and come to Monza, I would be there like that.
I'd go to Monza too.
We extend the invitation. I mean, obviously, I'm not going to Silverstone this year, but if you want to come across, and we can get together, we can get tickets going. You're more than welcome to come across.
We got to hit the European races. Not this year. Maybe next. In the following years.
Maybe the following year. I mean, say Spa is probably a cheaper one to go to. We could. What's to say we can't all meet up in Spa or something like that and camp it together and go and see the races and stuff like that.
Yeah. No, and the reason that I thought of that is because actually for the Canadian Grand Prix every year this is something special that they do, and I think any other race does this, but the promoters they actually open pretty much all of the track for anybody, whether you have a ticket or not, like anybody that's there, because for Montreal, the F1 weekend basically marks the start of the summer festivities. And Montreal is like it's a big party city, and over the summer they have like festival upon festival. But the first big weekend in Montreal is the F1 weekend, and they really go full out. Like they close major streets, and they have like they have free concerts everywhere. And because the race is so close to the city, I guess they can afford that. And one of the things that they do is that on the Thursday, and that's why this year we're going down on Wednesday night, so we can go bright and early to the circuit on Thursday morning. Because so what they do is they open it to anybody, and you basically jump on like a city bus, like their local bus, and it goes into the circuit, does a loop around the track backwards though.
Yeah.
And then it drops you off on the pit lane, and at the pit lane they have not only, well, it is Thursday, so the F1 teams are setting up, but beside the F1 teams, they have like all the other supporting races that are happening. So for Montreal is the Ferrari Challenge, and they have the Canadian Touring Championship and a few other races. They have all the cars there and all the mechanics sort of working on it, and you can actually like you can go like up to, especially like I thought it was weird how the Ferrari Challenge guys like and they're like they're racing like Ferrari 458s and stuff. You could go and like touch the engine, man. Like you could get in there.
Yeah, that'd be awesome. That'd be and that's what they need to do, really. Yeah. I mean, I think Silverstone now, because they've still got the old pit straight, so they split them up. So I think for the Formula One guys and maybe the GP2 guys have the new pit lane, and then all the other support races. So is it Formula 3 or GP3 and Porsche?
Yeah, they go Formula 1, GP2, GP3, Porsche, and sometimes there's another one.
The historic races sometimes, and you get the historic cups and stuff. But, I mean, there's obviously model cars that are around the place that you can go around and walk and touch, and Pirelli take a couple of cars there that you can have a look around at some Formula One car mock-ups. But there isn't that sort of interactivity at Silverstone. They've had it a few times, but it sort of wanes off a little bit. And I think the problem with Silverstone as well is, unlike Montreal where it's in the middle of a vibrant city, Silverstone's in the middle of Northampton, which if you don't know England very well, it's sort of in the middle of nowhere, really. I think the nearest sort of big place is Milton Keynes, which is just factories. It really is in the middle of nowhere. And you have to park in a field. So if it rains, you're stuffed because you can't get your car out.
Right. There was a thing with all the mud, like keeping people in or out of the track a couple of years ago, right?
Yeah, we were there that year.
Oh, yeah?
And they were saying...
How was that? That looked insane on TV.
It was ridiculous.
It was pretty bad.
They were saying to us, weren't they, Ben, that we shouldn't go. They say, stay away, don't bother coming. And we're like,
that was on the Saturday. They said, don't come on Saturday, take the day off and come back on Sunday. Wow. And we said, no, we ain't doing that. So we just went really early. Mm. And as you come off the motorway or dual carriageway to go towards the Silverstone circuit, the road runs past the circuit and the fields are on the right that you park in. And we got to a roundabout on that main road that runs along the circuit. I kid you not, there was a guy camping on the middle of the roundabout and just woke up and just got out and stood in the roundabout.
Good morning!
It was chaos because you've got that whole... There's quite a bad thing that happens in England when it rains, and when it rains badly. If we get any sort of extreme weather in Britain, the country shuts down. And it's the apocalypse, and there's horsemen come in, and the devils come in. They shut everything down, so you can't go anywhere, otherwise you'll die. So they have this huge rainfall, and people get in their cars, and they panic when they drive. And if they get their car stuck in the mud, the way they think they're going to get out of it is, I'll just floor it. So they're digging these huge trenches in the car park, and they're getting like 4x4s to dig them out and stuff. But it was it's made worse by stupid people. Stupid people made that worse because they were just tearing up the car park. Whereas if you just drove normally and just parked your car and then went and, I mean, by all means, jump around in the mud in your wellies or your, you know, your pants or whatever. But don't go driving around doing donuts. You can't get out. You just can't get out. Yeah.
It does
something. People had to help one another push their cars out. There was teams of people just going, yeah, if you push my car, then we'll push your car. And just people just pushed and they were just absolutely caked in mud,
oh my
and
God.
Rain and everything.
That's beautiful.
That's crazy.
It's good fun to watch.
We were driving out going, see ya.
Bye. That's cool though. I just like you said that you have your list of races that you'd like to check out. I definitely would love to go to Silverstone. And it's not gonna happen this year, but soon. And for sure it'll be definitely.
When is it?
Silverstone, it is in happening
July.
In July.
Ah,
yeah.
July 3rd, July the 5th,
July,
I think.
Yeah, July 5th, I think it is. July 5th.
Next year, Mike.
Yeah, next year.
Yeah.
If you're coming, let us know, and then because hopefully Dan will be going next year as well, and we'll all go together.
Oh, absolutely. That and Spa, obviously, like you
and
said.
Spa.
Yeah. Spa. Oh, yeah, Spa. Spa would be awesome.
Spa.
I think we looked on, I mean, I've looked at all the races to go to, and I think you have to. Obviously, you have your favourites and you want to go to, but you also have to pick a track on where you can get access to and where the grandstands are, because there's a lot of tracks that don't give you access to the good parts of the circuit. You only get to sit on like the pit straight. And it's like, well, that's great, but there's this really nice corner here where there's loads of action that happens, and I want to sit here. So, but I think maybe
it's a big
problem
with Germany.
Oh, I heard that Spa is pretty good with that. Like you can go all down like the Kemmel Straight and whatnot. Like, that's what I've heard.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think Spa is like Silverstone. You can go all the way around. Yeah. I think Germany, there's certain parts of the track, like the grandstands, that's you're restricted to that grandstand anyway. You can't go anywhere else. And obviously, it's quite expensive to sit in that grandstand anyway.
For sure.
It's not very spectator-friendly in that respect.
Cool. Well, guys, I think that we can end it on that bit of a note for now. Before we head out, I'd like to hear from you guys what you're looking forward to the most about the upcoming Spanish Grand Prix.
Ben, I'll let you go first.
How close Ferrari are going to be? How good? McLaren are going to be, whether Alonso can challenge for some points and what progress they've made. That they're probably the main few things, and whether Rosberg is going to be the same Rosberg that was in Bahrain, or he's going to go back to a whiny Rosberg and go back to acting Max Verstappen's age. Rather than
he has been such a little, you know, little bitch recently. But no. In Bahrain, actually, he showed that he at least still has some Maldonados, some balls.
I think for me, I've made a bold prediction a couple of weeks ago that I said that McLaren will score their first points in Europe, and last week. It doesn't look too far-fetched because of what Alonso finished 11th. So if we have any sort of more technical issues, that could happen. So I'm looking forward to see if that comes off and see how far McLaren have moved forward. But in this gap, you've got Rosberg's had a chance to reset his mind. Hamilton's is at the top, and it's tough to lead from the top sometimes. You've got to sort of keep yourself focused and keep yourself driven. And Raikkonen's now coming to the fore with Vettel. So you've got that front four is a really interesting dynamic. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens there. And I'd like to see if Williams have made a step and can catch the back of the Ferraris, because it would be really good to see that group come from four to six and get another British team with Williams, who are my favourite team, really. To get them in there.
They're so easy to love. Williams is
amazing.
Yeah. guys, thank you so much. And let's do this again sometime.
Yeah. We'll catch up. I mean, we've got there's that 4 week break, isn't there? There's a month off.
Yeah.
So we can catch up. And we can catch up through the season and sort of we'll jibe each other on Badger GP. The weekend we overtake Dan, that's the week we're coming back.
Yes.
Hopefully you'll be there.
Nice.
He's not in Jamaica.
Yeah, he's actually hiding just over there. Just off camera. Guys, it's been great. I guess we'll talk to you soon.
Yes, talk to you soon. Sorry,
thank you very much.
sorry we weren't as attractive as your last guest. Oh.
Wait, Ed, how good was her, eh?
She was brilliant. She was great. And we're looking to do something similar with getting maybe a karting guy on and following him through his or her through her career.
Yeah.
And I think it's a really good idea, that. And it's good that you've got one a female and one a South American driver as well, because...
You know, we only got it because Jay's Colombian.
But there have been some great South American drivers, and it's something that's lacking in the sport at the minute. Obviously, Maldonado's a bit of a butt of everyone's joke. So if she can come through,
yeah,
that'd be excellent. And that'd be what a coup for you guys to have her on your show.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to that.
We're hedging our bets.
Yeah. Hopefully next time that we have her on, we can actually see her face. All right, guys. Lovely to talk to you guys, and I'm sure that we'll see you down the road.
Oh, you're clever.
Keep up the good work, guys.
Yeah. Cheers.
See you guys.
That was awesome.
Wasn't that though?
Yeah.
Oh my god. We don't need Danny. We can do this on our own. I mean, you handled that mostly all of it, but you know.
Yeah. No, those guys are cool.
That was super cool, man. They were so friendly. They were so nice.
Yeah. No, and they actually, let's be honest, in terms of like technical stuff, they are probably
they know a lot of things.
Probably hitting more technical stuff than we are on the regular basis.
And us on our just wild speculations. That's my forte.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what we're here for, you know. You're welcome, everyone.
Internet. Come on.
There's been lots though going on with F1 that we didn't. I was actually hoping to touch with them on a variety of topics, but topics earlier. But there was just no time. And you know, we still have these 3 weeks. That Dan is coming back.
When does that start?
Well, right now. Okay, we're in the middle of it now.
Oh, are we now?
Okay. Yeah.
See how much I know. I'm a piece of shit.
The Spanish Grand Prix is like, it's on the 10th of May. So we have.
Oh shit.
Yeah,
okay.
We have some time for now. Dan is coming back for everybody. That Dan will be coming back from Jamaica, this week. So next week I'm sure we'll have something.
Something cooked up.
Yeah, something cooked up with him back, and we'll discuss many of the other news that are hitting the F1 teams. But I particularly am looking forward, on top of what Dan and Ben from 5Lights just said. I'm looking forward to it just to see like what new things, what new improvements the teams are going to come up with in Spain, because we've heard a lot of talk from many teams.
Tokens?
Tokens are going to be spent. Tokens are going to be spent.
That's all I know.
For sure. But also like aerodynamic upgrades.
Right.
We might see some teams with new livery, like new colors in their cars and stuff.
Oh my god.
Even. So that's going to be cool.
Oh, that's that kind of thing. Yeah.
Cheers. And that's all happening in 3 weeks or whatnot, or you know, I guess now it would be closer to two and a bit weeks. So I'm looking forward to see what the teams have been working on, because the thing is that these teams right now, they've been traveling halfway around the world from their home bases, because all of them are based out of Europe.
Right.
They've been traveling around. A lot of them just don't have the budget to bring in parts for this time. We've seen
right,
teams
that cost money.
Oh yeah, yeah. We've seen teams where they've basically have been running the exact same car from the beginning of the year. Now that may not sound as shocking, but no, like yeah, in F1, like the race that you're not bringing parts to improve is a race that you might not score points or whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of teams are definitely waiting, and this happens every year. They wait for what they call the European season to start, and that's when they come up with the big upgrades.
Mm.
And we see very exciting racing, and like we said at the beginning, like months and months ago when they were testing in Spain, because remember how they did the testing in Spain before the beginning of the year?
Yeah.
Well, now they're going back to one of the tracks they tested at. Oh. So this is a track that the teams know, and they've tested tires, they've tested sort of like the direction that they want the car to go in. So it's an important thing that they're going back to Spain, and it's also a track that is going to get packed because of Fernando Alonso. Mm-hmm. So we're going to see great crowds. We're going to see the cars developing, and we're going to see some great racing because Barcelona always has some great racing. So I'm looking forward to that.
That's exciting. So, okay, we have... okay, so what's the next one? Spanish Grand Prix?
Yeah, and right after Monaco, and then the Canadian Grand Prix.
I know. These guys got me so pumped up for the Montreal Grand Prix. Seeing them so excited about it, and they're like... When they said that was like one of their top ones, I was like, okay, shit, this is going to be... And guys, I just got a GoPro today, and I mean, I'm charging it. Look forward to some great Montreal Grand Prix GoPro footage that I'm going to be taking with the boys. It's going to look really fucking cool.
Yeah, that's good.
I'm really excited.
It's all coming up.
It's all coming up daisies. That's not a thing. It's not. Stop it.
Oh, shit.
All right.
We can end on that.
Let's end on that.
Yeah, let's go have a beer outside. It's sweet.
Oh, it's so nice.
Yeah.
I'm going to play with my devil sticks. All right, guys. Thanks again for watching.
Oh yeah, check us out. We're in many places. YouTube. We have a website now. Yeah, iTunes.
We've got Facebook.
We have Facebook. Facebook Flat Out Fever. Reddit Flat Out Fever. Twitter Flat Out Fever. Look us up. And if you like this tune, listen to bamboo.com.